If you track the motion of individual stars in the ultra-dense star cluster at the very centre of our Milky Way galaxy, you'll see that they swing in sharp orbits around some vast but invisible mass. That's the Sagittarius A star supermassive black hole. Now these are perilous orbits, and sometimes a star wanders just a little too close to the lurking monster, leading to its utter destruction in a spectacular phenomenon known as a tidal disruption event. Now, we've never seen a TDE in the Milky Way, but we've seen them in other galaxies, and we now know how to spot stellar destructions so extreme that they reveal properties of the black hole itself. What happens when a star gets a little too close to a galaxy's central supermassive black hole? Well, as it approaches, the gravitational force on the side of the star closer to the black hole gets stronger than the pull on the far side. This gravitational differential results in a tidal force that, from the star's perspective, feels like it's being stretched in the direction of the black hole and compressed in the perpendicular direction. If the star gets within a certain critical distance of the black hole, the tidal radius, the tidal force becomes greater than the force of gravity binding the star together. The star is smeared out in a fluid-like noodly mess in a process called spaghettification. Some of this material gets ejected outwards while more spirals rapidly into the black hole, leading to incredible temperatures before disappearing into the black hole. These tidal disruption events, or TDEs, are so rare that we've never seen one in our own Sag J star black hole, but we've seen around 100 candidate TDEs in distant galaxies. Even from Sag A star, and certainly from other galaxies, a TDE would appear to us as just a flash of light from the galactic center. But fear not, there is a way to get as close as we want to one of these stellar train wrecks, by recreating them in supercomputer simulations. By tuning those simulations to our observations, we're able to study matter moving in the strange warped space-time around a black hole. And recently, we've even predicted a type of extreme tidal disruption event never before seen that we may see very soon. Throwing virtual stars at virtual black holes is actually enormously challenging, and we've only just gotten really good at it. To understand how we do this and why it's so hard, let's start with some of the gravitational physics behind these tidal disruption events. We've been able to simulate motion under gravity for some time now. The Apollo program did the orbital mechanics of its spacecraft on supercomputers with the computing power of a handheld calculator from the 90s. These simulations used Isaac Newton's theory of gravity, calculating the gravitational force between all pairs of objects, seeing how those forces change velocities and how those velocities change positions over small time steps, then repeating over and over. The calculations are quick enough that modern supercomputers can calculate the interactions of millions of objects to simulate entire galaxies or even universes. But Newtonian gravity is only an approximation of how gravity really works, an approximation valid when gravity is weak. That's fine for most of the universe, and even for mild tidal disruption events like the one that may have torn apart a moon to form Saturn's rings. But to properly describe a TDE near a black hole, we need the full theory, and that's Einstein's general theory of relativity. Rather than describing gravity as a force, general relativity, or GR, describes the warping of space and time by massive objects, and explains gravity as the effect of that warping on the motion of objects. Although general relativity is incredibly well tested and certainly correct, it's also notoriously complicated. For one thing, the nice symmetries that lead to clean circular or elliptical orbits in Newtonian gravity no longer apply in regions of space where GR becomes important. As a result, orbits around black holes can be twisted and tangled over themselves, especially around rotating black holes. Within a certain distance from all black holes, there are no stable orbits whatsoever. This gravitational messiness has implications both for a disrupted star and for the complexity of simulating those disruptions on our computers. For the star itself, it means that within a certain distance, all material must either fall into the black hole or be flung back out. We can't have nice ring systems of stellar material in the region close to the black hole. And the complexity of these orbits makes our simulations much more computationally challenging. In GR, we describe the motion of objects under gravity in terms of geodesics, paths taken under pure gravity. To calculate the motion of an object in such a region, it's not enough to calculate the force at every point. You need to plot out the geodesics. In fact, you need to build a map of the warped spacetime. It gets much harder if you have to consider the star's own effect on that spacetime curvature. But fortunately for these TDEs, the star's mass is so piddling compared to the black hole that the star can be neglected. But we do have a different challenge. Once the star is disrupted, it's no longer a single object, it's a smeared-out fluid. To simulate this, we need relativistic hydrodynamics. We need to employ the equations of fluid motion for material travelling at close to the speed of light in a warped space-time. We need to consider a variety of complex effects like friction and the bath of intense radiation produced by that superheated material that can drive the infalling material outwards. Oh, and we need to simulate how that light escapes the vicinity of the black hole to make its way to us. The same warp space-time that destroyed the star also twists the paths of departing light in a phenomenon known as gravitational lensing. Until relatively recently, we've only been able to simulate piecemeal parts of this phenomenon, like the early time disruption of the star or the formation of a disk. But these days, modern state-of-the-art codes can follow a tidal disruption event from the incoming star all the way through its destruction to the observable flashes of light that we see. Cool, so what do these simulated TDEs actually look like? Well, there are different types. The most important factor in determining what happens is just how close the star gets to the black hole, whether its orbit takes it within certain critical distances. The most well-known such distance is the event horizon, the surface of no escape. For a non-rotating black hole, this is at the Schwarzschild radius, around 3 kilometers for a black hole with the sun's mass. If the star's orbit would take it across that surface, it is possible for it to drop directly into the black hole without any part of it escaping. This is called a direct capture event. Now, depending on the size of the black hole, it may be tidally disrupted before entering. That's the case if the tidal radius is larger than the event horizon, true for any black hole smaller than a few million solar masses. Then, the black hole slurps up the entire spaghettified stellar noodle. Larger than that, and the star is still a star as it submerges. These direct capture events typically don't produce much of an electromagnetic signature. The star just isn't ravaged enough to shine brightly before vanishing forever. These should also be quite rare due to the relatively small target of the black hole event horizon, so we'll leave these aside for now. At the other end of the spectrum is the partial TDE. If the star passes close enough to be significantly stretched but not enough to be disrupted, so outside the star's tidal radius, then the star may shed significant material from its outer layers, but enough remains intact that the star remains a star, fusion continues in its core, and the star settles down upon escape. But the real fireworks begin with the full tidal disruption event, also called a common TDE, because these are the ones most commonly observed due to their brightness. This is when the star crosses the tidal radius, but its orbit doesn't carry it directly through the event horizon. Let's take a look at a relativistic hydrodynamic simulation of a common TDE to see what should happen. This is a simulation of a star 3 times the sun's mass passing within the tidal radius of a 100,000 solar mass black hole. That's where the tidal forces are large enough that they overcome the star's self-gravity. Over about a day, the star completes its flyby, but it keeps expanding, producing a giant plume of plasma. The core of the star loses pressure and fusion cuts off. But that giant stream doesn't just keep going, not all of it anyway. The tail starts to fall back towards the black hole and then begins to loop back on itself. The material that hasn't escaped ends up on an elliptical orbit that can clearly be seen as a snake biting its tail, and much of the material that didn't escape finds stable orbits around the black hole, forming the start of an accretion disk. An important feature of this orbit is the violent choke point at the closest point of the orbit. This choke point is called a nozzle shock, caused by the tremendous speeds that the stellar material attains. It's at this point that friction and turbulence and other forces in the stream of debris cause potentially observable flares of photons. A common TDE can be bright enough to outshine the entire surrounding galaxy, but it seems that the universe is capable of doing even better. Simulations have revealed the possibility of something that astrophysicists are calling an extreme tidal disruption event, an ETDE. This should happen when a star's orbit takes it within the tidal radius of a black hole and very close to the event horizon, say 2 to 3 Schwarzschild radii for a non-rotating black hole. The result is a vastly more energetic phenomenon than the common TDE. We don't yet have a confirmed observation of an ETDE, but recent simulations are helping us to understand exactly what to look for and how to look. Let's take a look at the relativistic hydrodynamic simulation of this event. This one is by Dr. Teho Ryu at the Max Planck Institute and Gila at CU Boulder. This paper was just published last year, and it's the first to follow the ETDE from a star with realistic stellar structure to the hot mess that it gets shredded into. And by the way, the earlier simulations we saw are also by Dr. Ryu. This time we're throwing a one solar mass star, like our Sun, at a million solar mass black hole, aiming to skim just outside the event horizon. It begins somewhat similarly to a common TDE, however within seconds we see direct capture of some of the star, with an emphasis on some. The rest of it is dragged into a tail that whips around the black hole multiple times, leaving a spiral trail that was not seen with the elliptical orbit and the fallback that made the common TDE. Very soon, an entirely new phase emerges. Within tens of minutes, the windings of the tail merge together, leaving behind a circularized ring made up from the last bits of the star that narrowly escaped their demise. These remaining bits now sit in an expanding circular cloud. Though stable for quite some time, the innermost portions of the ring nevertheless begin to fall back towards the central black hole. As the insides of the ring fill in the previously empty cavity, the black hole accretes the material and a long-lived accretion disk is formed until eventually all of the surrounding material is ultimately either consumed or ejected. As the matter gets accreted by the black hole, much of that gravitational potential energy is converted to radiation energy, making a bright burst of light. In the extreme TDE, this luminosity increases very rapidly until it reaches what is called the Eddington luminosity. This is a sort of upper limit on the radiative output for a given black hole mass, where the outward radiative force directly balances the inward force of gravity. Any more radiation and material is blown outwards by the radiative winds. Being at this Eddington limit puts the system in a state of temporary equilibrium with outward radiation balancing gravity, but after a while, the outgoing radiation drops off and the black hole's gravity dominates again, enabling the black hole to finish gobbling up the stellar material. These extreme TDEs should be rare because the star has to make a very close approach. But it turns out that for larger supermassive black holes, these are the only tidal disruption events that can happen. That's because as the mass of the black hole grows, both the event horizon and the tidal radius grow, but the event horizon grows faster. So that at a few tens of millions of solar masses, the tidal radius is very near or even inside the event horizon. Approaching these masses, if a star gets close enough to be disrupted at all, it's also close enough to undergo an extreme TDE. So we now know what tidal disruption events should look like if you're actually close to one, but the real value of these simulations is to predict what they look like from Earth so we can actually test our ideas and potentially identify our first extreme TDE. So what do these TDEs look like to us here on Earth? Because they're too far away to resolve the spatial details, we really just see a point of light growing in the center of a distant galaxy where we expect the supermassive black hole to lie. That point brightens as the star disrupts and spreads out, and then fades away as the stellar material either falls back into the black hole or disperses. The timescale depends on the black hole mass. For a million solar mass black hole, the rise time is around a month, and then typically it'll have faded away within a year. For a common TDE, most of that light is emitted at visible wavelengths. We can also see radio flares as ejected material slams into diffuse stuff in the surrounding galaxy, producing shockwaves. Extreme TDEs are expected to be quite a bit more extreme, as one would hope. They should rise in brightness much more quickly. An ETDE around a million solar mass black hole should brighten over only a few hours instead of a month, and then maintain a more consistent brightness than the common TDE for up to a year before finally fading out. This is something that the new study revealed because the simulations found this temporary equilibrium as outgoing radiation helped resist gravity. Those simulations also predicted supercompact accretion with a temperature peaking at around 1,000,000 Kelvin. This results in a broad spectrum of light, with most photons being X-rays, and at around 10 times the luminosity of a common TDE. We find common TDEs in our visible light surveys of the sky. They don't happen very often, every several thousand years in a given galaxy, and most commonly around smaller supermassive black holes. We've never seen one directly in the Milky Way, but there are observed remnants such as radio lobes in the galactic center that would indicate one occurred a few thousand years ago. But ETDEs should be rarer than common TDEs because they require a closer approach and tend to happen around larger black holes, which are rarer than smaller ones. But Dr. Ryu and team estimate 1 per 15,000 years for a 20 million solar mass black hole. Now, to spot such a thing, we need to monitor a lot of galaxies, which is something new large field surveys can do, but we also need to do it at X-ray wavelengths, which is much harder than visible light wavelengths. Fortunately, we already have an instrument that may be up to the task. Erizeta is an X-ray detector on the Spectre-RG Space Observatory, and it's created an X-ray survey over the entire sky. Unfortunately, operation was suspended in 2022 before covering the X-ray energies needed to detect an ETDE. But Erizeta will soon resume its operations and finish its survey sometime in the next couple of years, and then our first ETDEs will hopefully shine out. And this will be a rare chance to witness the motion of matter in the region very close to a black hole event horizon. By comparing what we see with our observations with what we predict from our simulations, will let us test our models of these violent events, to test how these stars get ripped apart by black holes, and perhaps also to test our understanding of how gravity really works in the most extreme regions of space-time.